to everybody, and welcome to sunny Surrey. Hopefully it's going to be not quite as hot as it was in the last couple of days, where we were actually just peaking sort of 34 centigrade, which if you've got air conditioning is great, but if you haven't, it's not so good. But I'm glad to see today we have, and it's very nice to see so many, I was going to say old friends, I should be careful, not necessarily old friends, friends I've had for a long time. And some of them can look at their number of orbits they've made and make the calculation. But it's really nice to see many of you back again. And as always, of course, it's nice to welcome new faces. We've got a good, an interesting program for you, quite varied this morning. And I'm going to give you a little introduction in a moment to what we've been doing at SSTL. Now, I know some of you know us quite well, and other of you may not. So those that know some of the early details, you can forgive me, and the others, I hope you'll find it interesting. But before we do that, and before we kick off the 28th, it's unbelievable, it's quite incredible to think this is the 28th of these AMSAT colloquia. I remember when it all started in the first one, so 20 years later is quite astounding. But still, it's before we kick that off, I'm going to pass the microphone, or pass a microphone, over to Jim, who, as Honorary Secretary of AMSAT UK, is going to perform as my glamorous assistant with a few housekeeping notices and no jigs.
No jigs.
No jigs.
Good morning, everybody. Is that going? Testing, testing. Yeah, now it is. Good. Thank you very much. That reminds me, welcome to the BATC team, which seems gets bigger every year, and particularly our online viewers. Few admin things. A lot of you have been here before, and things haven't changed. I won't bore you with telling you where the fire exits are, but just follow me if there's a fire. We have in the shop, there's quite a lot of silent key stuff there, which we tried to sort of price to go. Quite a lot of it's gone already, so in the lunch break, do pay us a visit. We've also got the normal AMSAT shop stuff there. There's some polo shirts and LVB tracker kits and things like this. I think the only other thing I've got to say at the moment is that the lunch arrangements, you can do what you like for lunch. Go down to Tesco's, have none, have a five-course lunch in the hotel. What we find is a very convenient way of doing it is to order a sandwich from the reception desk in the business centre and give the lady a fiver, and then the sandwich and your drink is waiting for you when the session's finished. There are apparently three people who just left a fiver and not chosen what their sandwich is. So I don't quite. If you're one of them, you might want to quickly dash out and say you want a beef one or a prawn one or something like that. Otherwise, you'll get Hobson's choice. And I think that's all I've got to say. Back to you, Martin. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jim. And yes, again, I'd just like to thank our TV crew, which looks more professional every year, for supplying the support which allows those that can't join us to see us from afar. And of course, welcome to all those that are watching us online. Just to add, by the way, to Jim's note about lunch, if you do go down to Tesco's in the last year or two, I don't know whether you've been, it was there last year, but there is now a Costa Coffee, so you can get a coffee and a sandwich there just across the road if you want to stretch your legs in the afternoon, or lunch at least. So without further ado, what I thought I'd do is to give you a quick update this morning on what's been happening here at Surrey. Just to start out by explaining a little bit about who we are, what we do, and for those of you that are perhaps new here, give up some background and others catch up on activities for this year. So really it is my great pleasure, both as Chairman of AMSAT UK, but also the Executive Chairman of SSTL and Director of the Space Centre, to welcome you all here. Those of you that had an opportunity to take our little minibus and have a look around the clean rooms either last night or this morning. Hope you get some idea of some of the spacecraft that are underway. So, as we know, space is part of our everyday lives. We use it extensively, you know, for communications, for timing, navigation, looking at agriculture, disasters, and it's something that's really become increasingly embedded in our daily lives. Our national economy and infrastructure depends on it, and it's really fantastic to see that in the last, I suppose it's really 2 years, that the support from our government for space in the UK has increased dramatically. The UK now, if I remember it correctly, we are now the third largest contributor to the European Space Agency. I think that's up from number 9 2 years ago. So it's really quite an incredible turnaround for UK space. There's been a lot of investment in both national and international programs. And I must admit, I'm very rarely do I ever praise governments, or indeed ministers, or indeed even agree with them. And whilst I don't necessarily agree with the politics, I have to say their insight and their commitment to supporting space and the dramatic turnaround that we've seen recently is all to their credit, and particularly to our Space Minister, David Willetts, who really has championed this and pushed through the increased funding in government. And of course, I'm sure you'll all be very pleased to see that the UK is now returning into the launchers. And that just last week it was announced some £60 million going to be directed to support the first stages of development of a new launch process, which, if it really comes to fruition over the next decade, will truly revolutionise access to space. And of course, that's something which we have very great interest here, because launches are getting actually more difficult and more expensive, and anything we can do is going to make them more readily available and preferably cheaper, the better, both for our professional and of course our amateur activities. So here at Surrey, what we're doing essentially is trying to change the economics of space from the satellite end. I'd love to do the launch a bit as well, but not yet. And as you probably are aware, we focus on small satellites, particularly using the latest commercial off-the-shelf or terrestrial technologies to try to provide highly capable but lower cost spacecraft. So we have two organisations here, as I sort of introduced. SSTL, which was spun out from the university approaching, nearly 30 years ago, and is owned by EADS. They are our shareholder. We operate as an independent company within EADS, but it's nice to have a rich parent to provide us with some guarantees when we undertake larger contracts, and that's why the transition from the university was made, because the university is essentially a charity, and if we undertake large contracts and our customers want some guarantees, the university can't really provide those unless it sells the students and all the buildings. It doesn't get much for the students anyway. So SSTL focuses on operational missions for our professional services, and also providing Earth observation services to the subsidiary DMC International Imaging, or DMCII. Now, SSTL has grown, and in fact, when I looked, I think I wasn't able to talk to you last year, and I looked the year before, and actually we were 420 people when I last spoke, and we're now 617 on Friday, and probably more by Monday. So you can see that we've been growing really quite rapidly. Our revenues are about 100 million a year, so it gives you an idea, and we've got three locations in the UK. It's not just here. We have the headquarters here at Surrey, obviously, but we have our optical unit down in Sevenoaks in Kent, and we have a unit in Borden in Hampshire, which does all our composite materials. So when those of you that had a look in the clean rooms and saw the DMC-3 spacecraft, sort of big sort of black nose coming out of it, that's the optical camera that's made from composite materials, which were all fabricated in our facility in Borden, which is about 20 minutes drive away. And in addition to the UK business, we also have a subsidiary in the US based in Denver, which is about 16 or 17 people, and they won their first mission just this February. So just so you can see how it all fits together, actually SSTL, with our parent EADS, has really got four divisions. We have SSTL, which focuses on in the UK here in, as you know, we have our US office, we have our subsidiary DMCII, and much to everybody's surprise, we have a launch services company which is based in the Isle of Man for regulatory benefits. And that helps us in the access to getting launch services. Of course, and as you see in the top right, we have Surrey Space Centre, and there's a dotted line with IP going in one direction and pounds going in the other. IP is the intellectual property, and so the relationship between the Space Centre and SSTL is that they're actually totally separate in terms of their financing and their accounting and everything else and management, but we have a very close link, so that the research that gets done in the Space Centre can get exploited by SSTL, so we have an IP agreement between the two, and in return we give them some money so they can develop their research. Most of that money is unfettered. We have some projects which we focus, others we give it to them so that they can pursue ideas of their own. We look at it each year, if they spend it on wine, women and song, they don't get so much next year. So there's a good control loop that just keeps it in place. So Space Centre, of course, is over where we used to hold the colloquium some years ago, and those of you that have been here then will be familiar with it. There's about 100 researchers now focusing on the over-the-horizon research that we need for the Space Centre. And it's really this sort of synergy, this combination of the research with our staff and students in the Space Centre and the exploitation through the company and SSTL that's really made Space at Surrey a success. It's not easy to make it work, and it's even more difficult now. We're 2 kilometres away, I can tell you. But we make use of web streaming and so forth, the seminars, and to try to keep that going. So there's a very close link, and it's a very important part of our activity. So their Over the Horizon research focuses on a whole range of topics, everything you could possibly think of that might be of interest in supporting space exploration. And some of it, of course, is things that we can use quite near to hand. So if they develop some new algorithms for attitude control, yes, we can upload those into spacecraft quite quickly, next week if it works. Others, such as vertical flying machines for Mars, we're probably not going to be using next fortnight. But we are looking at it for in the long term. So really, the Space Centre looks at sort of ideas that are coming from 3 to 25 years ahead. SSTL tends to pick those up and exploits them on a sort of from now to 3 to 4 years time horizon. But it's this relationship going between the two which is really important. So over the last 31 years, we've now launched 41 satellites. But in addition, we've got some 19 new satellites under various stages of construction and 27 new payloads. Of course, we do a lot of operations, and along the bottom you'll see all the different launch vehicles that we've employed. So we've used 10 different launch vehicles, the latest on the right being the Indian PSLV, and I'll sort of touch on that a little bit at the end. I have to say that so far, out of those, and I think it's 25 or 26 different launches, so far we haven't suffered from a rocket failure. So, touching wood. What do we actually do very quickly? Well, we do everything from mission definition through the design, manufacture, construction, assembly, integration, test, then arranging the launch. We don't have our launch pad on the research part yet. And then obviously the commissioning operations and so on. And we also do a lot of training in partnership with a number of our customers around the world. You'll see the latest down the bottom right, you'll see the Nigerian satellites N2 and their experimental satellite NX, and some of our Nigerian colleagues who worked with us for about 2.5 years here. The main things that we tend to build are on the left. We tend to focus primarily on the sort of microsatellites in the 100 kilo range and 150 kilo sort of enhanced microsatellite, and then some of the larger mini satellites at the sort of 300, 400 kilo range. But of course also payloads, and you may have seen, those of you that are looking through the cleanroom windows, some of our Galileo payloads being put together. First of which have been integrated now and ready, undergoing test in Germany and in ESA, and of course operations and the exploitation of Earth observation data through the company DMCII. And we work with an awful lot of people. I just had a quick pick to say, well, let's just say over the last 10 years, who have we worked with? And so you can see a very wide-ranging group of people with whom we've collaborated. A lot in the Far East, of course, in particular, where we've had very strong links, but growing links also in most recently in Kazakhstan. Of course, how did it all start? This is all very nice looking at it. If you go back and look in the dim, distant Jurassic period, you'll see where it all came from, and I won't go through in detail, but I thought it'd be just nice to glance back, and in 1975, this whole thing started in the bar. Just down the road, looking at what can we do with satellites, getting involved with AMSAT-Oscar 6, then 7, then 8, doing a On the left-hand side, you see one of the very early control stations, which was used for controlling, I think this one's Oscar 8. And then our first satellite, USAT-1. You can see, you know, trendy jumpers of the 1970s era. And of course, you can see what happens when you play with satellites. You end up with a whole heap less hair at the end of it. Early launches on the NASA Delta as a PBAC under the Solar Mesosphere Explorer, and then later Landsat. And then equally trendy 1980s ground stations, where you can see some of the very first 8080 microcomputers being used to control the satellite. Believe it or not, I think if you... let's try pressing that button. Yep. If you've got really good eyesight, just here, you'll see on this... well, here there's eight switches and a toggle and push button. Programming the first onboard computers, we actually set up the 8 bits of each binary word and then press the button in order to send one byte to the spacecraft. And loading a 30-byte program was a major achievement. So that's where it all started, and we had our kind of an iconic antenna tracking ground station, which was a dish taken off HMS Wakeful. Unfortunately, they took off the anti-aircraft gun and we put on a dish. The anti-aircraft gun would have been more impressive, but still. We used that for many, many years for tracking until it became just a little bit too sluggish for what we were doing. Of course, the early satellite missions focused very much, actually, on the sort of digital development of digital store and forward communications that we have used in the amateur service, and then seeing how that could be applied to some of the aid organizations in remote regions. And then that developed fairly rapidly through various other types of programs in low Earth orbit, technology demonstration, radio surveys, looking at space weather. And then, of course, most recently into Earth observation and navigation and timing, moving further out into orbit. So I'm going to just focus a little bit on the Earth observation, because it's, you know, you're all familiar with communication, so I don't need to say much about that. And also, you can't really demonstrate it very easily on a PowerPoint. But the Earth observation is a little bit easier to envisage. And many, of course, of you will be aware of the formation back in around about 2001 of the International Disaster Monitoring Constellation, which was to bring together a whole series of these small microsatellites, launch them in three or four launches into the same orbit, phase them around the orbit, and then have the cameras on board, sweeping wide area cameras, sweeping out an area so that as the satellites went round one after the other, we were able to cover all the Earth's surface in a 24-hour period. And this was an interesting combination with quite a sort of Catholic grouping, because we had Algeria, China, Nigeria, Turkey, UK and Spain all working together to run this constellation. They all own their own spacecraft, but then they work together in a collaborative, cooperative mode in order to respond to natural disasters and exploit the data for both humanitarian but also for commercial use. So a number of the applications of the DMC has been in clearly in disaster response. The Nigerian satellite, Nigeria Sat 1, was one of the first satellites to provide imagery for the Katrina disaster in the Gulf of Mexico. And the DMC provided actually quite a unique service in the Asian tsunami, which struck an enormously wide area, which was impossible to cover with traditional satellites. But because of the combination of the constellation and the wide swath, we were able to provide that coverage to help develop maps to aid the recovery process. But in addition to disasters, looking at many aspects of climate and the environment, particularly looking in the Amazon for the effects of illegal logging and the shrinking of the rainforests, providing every 6 months a map so people can see, you know, what's been happening, build up pictures of what's happening to the destruction of the rainforest and seeing if we can reduce that. But also more commercial applications such as precision agriculture. So we can look at a field, work out what the health of the crop is around that field, and then give the farmer guidance as to how much fertilizer he should put where in his field, so that A, he doesn't waste fertilizer, and perhaps as important, so it saves money, and as important, he doesn't over-fertilize and then end up with nitrate poisoning or pollution of the local waterways. Now, one of our early higher resolution satellites, Beijing 1, was retired last year after just over 7 years of service. This was our first sort of so-called high resolution spacecraft, 4 meters panchromatic imaging, as you can see here, looking at aircraft on a runway in, I think, somewhere in Iran, as it happens. And also taking that data and fusing both the panchromatic data you just saw with multispectral data at medium resolution to provide this type of imagery, which was used in the preparations of the Beijing Olympics, looking at the effects of development in the various townships around so that they could plan and monitor the development for the Olympics. And by the way, we also did some similar things for the UK Olympics. Now, the last time I spoke, which was in 2011, it was just before the launch of our latest Earth observation satellite, NigeriaSat 2, alongside its medium resolution partner NX. And I think I was just about going off to the launch site in Yasny, in the very southern part of Russia, middle of the desert there. So we had a successful launch. The spacecraft is about a 300 kilo satellite. In fact, if those of you that looked through the clean room this morning, the sort of grey bit on the bottom of the black tube is essentially the bus which was used for NigeriaSat 2. NigeriaSat 2 had a camera which was embedded in the body, as you can see here, provides 2.5 meter resolution. For the satellite you saw there, that provides 1 meter resolution, which doesn't sound like a big change, 2.5 to 1 doesn't sound that much, but you can have a look at the difference in the size of the camera tube when you look at the one that's sticking out on that, and I'll have a slide of that in a moment so you can see. This satellite has been working extremely well in orbit. Actually, we'll try and drop the lights a bit, perhaps. Can somebody press some random buttons and see if the lights go down or fire alarms go off? And then, because I'm going to show a few. Yeah, Graham, they're high technology, well, experts, yeah. Let's try that. Poof, that's ideal. No, we don't need, not all of them off, because then I need to see if people start snoring. I need to... Okay, good. Thank you. Right, that gentleman can already go. So, this is an example of the 2.5 meter panchromatic data taken over Dubai. Those of you that spend their ill-gotten gains going to posh hotels, you can see the tallest building just here, the Dubai Tower. If you then take and combine this with the multispectral data, a picture over New York. Oh, the lights have a mind of their own. Maybe I should press another button here. Maybe it'll do something different. And to give you an idea of the sort of quality of the data, here's an image over Salt Lake City Airport. And if we zoom in a bit there, you can see the aircraft on the runway. And aircraft aficionados will be able to tell me what type it is. You can actually count the engines on that, which looks like a 727 or something. So this gives you an idea of what can be done with a spacecraft, which I can just about sort of put my hand on top and just about put my arms, not around it, but either side. It weighs about 300 kilos. Imagery is here taken topically over Egypt. It's sort of murky. You can see the city here, the desert on the left, and if we zoom in on this, hopefully, you'll be able to see the pyramids of Giza here and here, the Cheops, Khafre, pyramids, and it's very interesting to have a look and see around in the deserts of below this how much other archaeological stuff is you can still see below the sands, and of course there's an awful lot there that can be excavated in due course. And just bring you up to date, this is a picture from, I'm not sure if it was yesterday or the day before, of the UK, one of the few times when the UK is almost entirely cloud-free. This was taken by one of the DMC, I think it was UK DMC 2 spacecraft. Of course, red, by the way, for those of you that are not Earth observation aficionados, red is green. The red here is essentially shows the vegetation, and the grey areas, the built-up areas. And if we zoomed in into London on that larger image, then this is what you would see, and again you can see the Millennium Dome there, and various other features, Buck House over here somewhere, That's the sort of same, we've got that resolution right the way across the whole of the UK. Now, one of the advantages of this constellation is that because we can image every day, we can build up these sort of pictures, and you can use this for change detection. So you can build up a database, and then you can have a look and see over the period of time how things are changing. Now, you will all that are familiar with us remember the launch of GOVA, the first of the Earth, ESA and EC navigation satellites. That was finally retired last year after over 7 years of operation in its very high radiation orbit, 23,000 kilometers out, and after its original 2.5 year planned lifetime. It's still working, by the way, but it's been switched off so that it doesn't interfere with the other constellations that are now being prepared and tested. But we are able to use the spacecraft for experimental purposes, and after 7 years we're able to switch on our GPS receiver on board, which is able to then take fixes from above the GPS constellation altitude. So it was, we're still using it for experimental purposes, but lasted for a long time. And in our clean rooms you will have seen some of the payloads that are now being built. So we're building 20, combined with, together with our partners in Germany, OHB, the full operational constellation of Galileo. That's 22 satellites. We have to churn out one every 6 weeks in order to be able to populate the system, so it's going to be quite a major undertaking. And if you peered through the clean rooms, I'm not sure where your tour took you, but if you went past the not the, the assembly clean room but the manufacturing clean room, you'll see actually we have now robotic systems for pick, place and assembly of the subsystems, because in with the 22 spacecraft, a number of the units in there, like remote terminal units inside the spacecraft, we're producing now hundreds of these things. So it now starts to be worthwhile to have robotic assembly techniques. And of course, once we've got those robotic assembly techniques, we can use it for the manufacture of even our smaller spacecraft. So here you see the payload for Galileo being put together, the hydrogen masers here. They don't have the big sort of vent out in once they're in orbit, just to keep them nice and cool here. So there's a lot of wiring that goes into to this system. So this is not, you know, on the small satellite scale of things. So you can see that, you know, we're sort of now reaching upwards as well as downwards. And what you were seeing in the clean room is the next generation of the Earth observation missions. And I haven't updated, which I should, this picture, but here you can see the spacecraft. So here is the spacecraft platform, a little bit like we had on N2, and this thing is the telescope. Now, the telescope doesn't just start there, it actually starts down here. And in fact, it's so big that I could actually sleep in it. If we got on there, it's a bit of a tight squeeze, but if I don't eat too much, I can get in. So this is a carbon composite telescope to provide us with a 1 meter resolution. Right on the top of the spacecraft here are the star cameras. We've just been going through our vibration testing at Astrium in Portsmouth, and I haven't heard any squeaks, so hopefully it all went well. In addition, we've now kicked off a project that we were just about to do when I last gave a presentation here, which is Novasar. This is trying to do for radar remote sensing what we've done for optical imaging, and that is to produce a smallish 400 kilo radar satellite using S-band, focusing on maritime surveillance, deforestation and flood monitoring, but at a very low cost, around about £45 million, which is more money than I get paid, you'd be glad to hear, but it's still cheap in radar terms. And we've started work. This is a combined project between SSTL and Astrium, because Astrium have a lot of experience in radar payloads. New missions coming up. Well, we're now working on a new mission called EarthMapper. This is to take our sort of 100 kilo spacecraft with some of our latest miniaturized avionics and to produce a constellation where we'll be able to image the entire Earth's surface, you know, the land surface, the entire Earth land surface every 24 hours at 22 meters resolution, or thereabouts, 20 meters resolution. And this is, again, to build up a database so that we can have every day essentially a database of all the cloud-free areas of the land world's land surfaces. And then once you've got this database, you can then essentially have different apps which drill down into the database to extract different types of information. So every day we will have a new update to the database, and then you build this up, and then you can look at the various phenomena that change on a daily, weekly, seasonal basis. This can only really be done by the combination of actually the latest of developments in microelectronics, which allow us to not only have good images, but also be able to cope with the enormous amounts of data that this starts to produce. So 13 years ago, we had our infamous SNAP satellite, the first of our small nano satellites that was launched. You've probably familiar with it. It took some interesting pictures in orbit. It chased after one of the other satellites. And that was really the basis for the development of really miniature systems. And that went on this year to with the launch of Strand, which was launched on an Indian PSLV in February. And I won't steal Chris Bridges' thunder, who's going to give you a talk, I believe, later, either today or tomorrow morning, I'm not sure which, on the details of that mission. But alongside Strand on PSLV, we also launched another microsatellite called Sapphire, which is a space surveillance mission for the government of Canada. And this is looking to try to map all the various objects, including debris, that's in orbit, so we can get a better picture of the orbital debris environment. And this is particularly important because debris is becoming a more important and concern to us. Just earlier this year, we signed an agreement with Taiwan to, again, build something like 12 microsatellites to on a program called COSMIC. This will be the second constellation in the COSMIC system. And this uses GPS occultation, so observing GPS satellites as they drop down through the ionosphere and atmosphere or stratosphere and troposphere, and looking at the effects on the transmissions in order to calculate total electron densities and various other aspects and temperature profiles of the upper atmosphere and ionosphere in order to provide improved information for weather and other related matters. So this is something that we're just about to start, and I say we'll be producing again 12 spacecraft with payloads, possibly in collaboration with the US, is still being discussed. And we just also got a new mission with our colleagues in Kazakhstan. So we're going to launch a satellite we've been building with them for the last couple of years called MRES, Medium Resolution Earth Observation Satellite. It's just going through its final testing, and it's going to be, it was due to be launched this year, but it's probably going to slide into spring of next year. And a new satellite called Space Technology Satellite, which is going to be again a collaboration where we're going to have a sort of a technology spacecraft, a bit like the technology demonstration satellite for the UK, where we're going to have teams together and try out new ideas. And they're also going to participate in the Novosar constellation, probably on the second satellite. And building on our CubeSat experience, we're going to colleagues in the Space Center developing a mission called CubeSail, specifically to address the debris issue. This is a passive debris device, so we're going to put out a large sail in order to reduce the orbital lifetime of spacecraft. That's going to be followed on by another mission, which is called Remove Debris, which will actually work in conjunction with Astrium to capture debris and actively remove it from orbit, so that we can try to minimize or reduce the current trend, which is going rather rapidly towards a chain point of a chain reaction, where debris is growing and debris hits debris, and then the whole thing sort of runs away. If we can just remove a few pieces of critical debris every year, we can reverse that trend and bring us away from this sort of tipping point. The Space Center's got a very interesting program, been running now for a couple of years, and again we're hoping to launch the first demonstration in 2015 of using nanosatellites to be assembled in orbit and reconfigured in orbit to provide large-scale optical apertures, which we can't do with single spacecraft. So the James Webb telescope is about the biggest thing you could consider launching on a single launch vehicle. Anything bigger than James Webb is going to require some form of in-orbit assembly. And so this is the first step in along this. This is not an easy thing to do, by the way. We will launch a cluster of these small satellites. They then separate, and they then go out and join up together in different Lego shapes, depending on what type of aperture we want to construct. And so the first of these to demonstrate this in-orbit rendezvous, docking, and Lego approach, we're hoping will be ready for 2015. So come to the 2015 AMSAT colloquium and get the latest news then. Of course, we're continuing work within the UK with technology demonstration satellite number one, which is due for a launch originally around about October time, but after the Proton failure, we're waiting to see what the impact of that is, because unfortunately, as you probably learnt, the Proton went up, and then because some they fitted all the gyros upside down, it then went like this. And then like that, and when it went like that, it all landed on the more or less on the launch pad that we were due to use for TDS2. So the guys on the launch pad which were watching it were fine, but unfortunately it spewed a lot of amyl heptil all over the launch pad we were planning to use for TDS1, and so consequently they're going to go and wash that down with fairy margarine liquid before we go. So hopefully that's going to be launched, well, we hope towards the end of this year, hopefully only a couple of months delay. And that has a number of experiments with a whole range of folk in the UK, actually, and I haven't listed them all here, but from a number of universities, schools experiments, and industry, and includes a sail to demonstrate the part of this not solar sailing, but the deorbiting mechanism, and also early a small part of our radar payload to be able to demonstrate and reduce some of the risk for our Novosar mission. So we're really hoping that can get up pretty soon. So this is a sort of a quick update on what we're doing here at sort of Space at Surrey. As you see, it's really a combination of both academic research and commercial enterprise, and it's really, you know, the 600, well, it's actually more than 700 people now that are on this site working on small satellites. You know, it's something we have in common is that we're really sort of passionate about space, whether it's in the manufacturing, the design, or the operation of the satellites. Stuart Eaves received one of the Arthurs in Glasgow this year, this last week. Stuart is one of the people in the in SSTL who spends a lot of time actually doing tours and doing lectures and so forth. Apart from his professional duties, he's really interested in trying to promote interest in space, and Tim Peake presented him with his Arthur last Wednesday or Thursday, whenever it was. And our whole motivation comes out of the amateur spirit of doing more with less, or whatever you've got in the box. Well, it's not what we've got in the box these days so much, but it's what we can find and what we can exploit from all the technologies that go into your laptops and computers and iPhones and the rest of it. What can we do with that to do more, essentially quicker and with less money? So thanks very much. That's a quick update on our activities at Surrey. And any questions before we go to the real star? I'm just the warm-up act, by the way. Alistair is the real McCoy. But before we before I introduce Alistair, any questions or anything anybody wants to grill me on? Says he, staring at you. Make sure you're not going to grill me. Yep.
How do you manage not to give away a secret when you perhaps got a problem with another company? But if you solve that problem,
so the question, in case anybody didn't hear it, is how do we avoid giving away our secrets? Well, it's a question that I get asked quite a bit, actually, because some of our programs actually are, you know, specifically aimed at training and transferring know-how to develop teams in developing countries. And in fact, I think we've trained something like 6 of the new space agencies in places like Algeria, Nigeria, Malaysia, and so on. And, well, first of all, we have very few what you would call patentable trade secrets. Our view is we're exploiting technologies that have been done, so actually it's the know-how of how to exploit it in the first place. And yes, you can try and hold that, you know, to yourself, but actually the field's moving so quickly that if we tell somebody what we're doing, then by the time they picked up and learned about it and got going, hopefully we're, you know, further downstream. And that's an incentive for us to keep innovating and keep thinking. Of course, you know, there are, I should just say that there are export restrictions on some of the things that we do. And we also always have to make sure that we abide by that. That's the, you know, disclaimer for any of you that are working for the CIA in here. Alistair.
Alistair Scott. I really shouldn't be asking you this one, putting you on the spot, but how do you find working with Astrium?
No, but seriously, because we're all friends here, so I can be frank. And although Alistair used to work for Astrium, I hope now you've severed your bonds. It's actually the history of large companies taking over small companies is awful. I mean, it's dire. If you look at them, 19 out of 20 small companies taken over by or acquired by big companies either sort of disappear into the big company or get closed down or just sort of, you know, die. And so when we were looking to change the shareholding of SSTL, which actually, by the way, started around about the year 2000, and it took us to 2008 to find a good partner, and we had, that was the third attempt. So we had three sort of matchmaking attempts, and the first two, we didn't find anybody that we felt comfortable with and the university felt comfortable with was going to sort of really take care of the company. And on the third occasion, we got, you know, quite a lot of interest. There were over 16 serious contenders. That was whittled down to about half a dozen, and then we had a look at the best. And if I speak frankly, and I've said this to my boss in Astrium, so he knows, you know, we were sort of surprised that Astrium came up with the most imaginative offer. And the university had to do this because, as I said earlier, you know, it doesn't have money, and it wasn't that we needed cash. What we needed was guarantees. If something did go wrong with one of our missions and the customer wanted some of their money back, and they wanted guarantees for that, the university just can't do that because they're not a financial institution, so that's why we had to make the change. And Astrium came up with the most imaginative overall. Wasn't quite the highest in cash terms, but it was the most imaginative. And there was, you know, again, quite honestly, some trepidation when the transfer occurred, because we didn't know what was going to happen, although we believed it was good. I have to say, since then, actually, it's worked out better than expected, and it was the best thing that ever happened to SSTL, because it freed us, gave us the ability to go after things like Galileo, like the DMC-3 missions, you know, which are hundreds of millions. The university just could not possibly have taken that risk. And we operate, as I said earlier, independently from Astrium. We can compete against our Astrium colleagues. The only ground rules I have from my boss in Paris is, you know, one, don't lose money, otherwise we'll come and help you, and probably don't want that help. And number two, you can compete with our Astrium colleagues, but only on a level playing field. You know, we're not allowed to do anything slippery, we can't undercut, do loss leaders, but if we produce a product and we offer it to a customer and the customer says we prefer yours compared to our parent company's offering, so be it. And that's the way it's worked. So it really has worked very well. And in addition to that, of course, things like Novasar would never have happened unless without the working with Astrium, because we've been working for a decade here on radar and not quite got there. We got very quite close, but not quite there. And it was after the acquisition by Astrium, and we could put, you know, having demonized each other for the last decade, and it took a little few months to wash that out of our heads. But, you know, then we could sit together and say, look, actually, you know, you guys are doing this and you guys are doing that, let's bring them together. And the result was, after 6 months, we had Novasar, and off it went, and we got support from the government to produce it. So the short answer is it's working extremely well, much to everybody's surprise, and you know, we hope it will continue like that. And that's not just because you work for Astrium, I've said this to anyway, before we move on, Graham's flapping at the back there.
One last question from, sorry, over the internet. Rob G3UGX is asking, are there any plans for amateur satellites which are not LEO, for example, elliptical orbit, which would be observable for a longer period? I'm not sure whether that question is correctly addressed in your direction, but...
I think at the moment, yes. The short answer is yes, there are some plans. The plans are sort of in the... You know, not at a very concrete stage, but we are certainly looking at options, and we may want to discuss that a little bit later. But we've always been looking at spacecraft in different orbits, not only the highly inclined elliptical orbits, but also the potential for amateur transponders in the geostationary orbit. So those are things that have been working on for many years, and we continue to do so, and hopefully something might hatch. Right, I think that's it. So now, without further ado, I can introduce the real speaker for the